Welcome to the Table Podcast, where we discuss issues of God and culture, brought to you by Dallas Theological Seminary.
Welcome to the Table, where we discuss issues of God and culture. I'm Mikel Del Rosario, Cultural Engagement Manager here at the Hendrick Center at Dallas Theological Seminary. And our topic today is helping your church defend the faith. How can we help our brothers and sisters in the church explain the faith to people who see Christianity differently and grow in their faith in Christ? And my guest in studio today is Nathan Wagnon. Welcome.
Thanks, Mikel. It's great to be here, man.
Yeah, good to have you again. Second time, right? On the table.
Yeah.
And your title is a pretty unique one. It's Director of Equipping and Apologetics at Watermark Community Church. And do you know anybody else who has Pastor of Apologetics or Director of Apologetics in their title?
Yeah, not personally, no. I mean, I'm sure they're probably out there somewhere, but I would imagine there's not very many of us.
Yeah, so, it's a pretty rare thing for sure. So we're happy to have you here.
Yeah, thanks, man.
To talk about this particular topic. And you are a DTS grad.
Yeah, yep. THM 2006 as a New Testament guy.
Okay, great. New Testament is my area as
there,
well.
That's so, right, yeah.
Yep.
I love it.
And what did you do after DTS, and kind of get us up to speed from the time you graduated until you started working in your church now?
I was here. Actually, was in this room. It looked different back then, but was in this room and graduated in the spring of 2006, and then about a year and a half later, I joined the military, which was a pretty significant left turn. If you understand the whole story, then it makes sense. But a lot of people are like, "Wait, you went to seminary and then you joined the military?" I grew up Southern Baptist. I went to a Southern Baptist university, and then I came straight here and worked on my THM, and then I kind of looked at my background and was like, hey, I've done a lot of different, you know, Christian ministry things, but they've always been in the context like of a Christian environment. Mm-hmm. And so, and I wrote my thesis on the Great Commission. So mm-hmm. was thinking about, hey, how do you do kind of incarnational ministry like Jesus did in a totally secular environment? Mm-hmm. And a mentor of mine here, Andy Seidel, mm-hmm. Kind of pushed me toward the army, and I looked at it and was like, you know what? I think that's what the Lord's got for me next. Mm. So I went into that, and it was a massive culture shock. I literally went from going on an expedition with the Center for the Study of New Testament Manuscripts to basic training.
Oh, wow.
It's like, this is very different, you know, like academic work to the army. Yeah. But you know what? I found that the Lord really used that time. I was an infantryman and deployed twice to Afghanistan, and just got a broader sense for, you know, what was going on in the world, mm-hmm. but then also what was going on just in our military with those, you know, young men and women who are serving our country. And I was able to lead Bible studies and lead people to the Lord. And I just had I had a very incarnational in it type ministry while I was there. Mm-hmm. And after my second deployment, my wife got pregnant with our first child, and it was like, hey, you know what? I'm probably done being shot at, you know, so let's transition. Mm-hmm. And so we moved back here and started my doctorate of ministry in discipleship and spiritual formation at Biola University. And then I've been on staff at Watermark the whole time that I've been doing that. So about 6 years as the Director of Equipping and Apologetics. So
now, was that something in place before you got here? Did you apply for that job?
You know, it's, I mean, I was at Watermark, which Watermark was really young when I was there, while I was going through seminary, when mm-hmm. I was going through DTS. And so I was a lay leader and pretty heavily involved before I joined the military. So when I came back, I had a lot of relational connections mm-hmm. there. And I came back, and the position did not exist. The ministries that I now oversee existed in some form, mm-hmm. But didn't really have a whole lot of like oversight from a staff perspective. And so when I came back, I remember the very first day I came back, my boss at the time, Blake Holmes, who's now our campus pastor, came and got me and was like, hey, we're going to go meet these guys. And we sat down with the apologetics team at Watermark, which is kind of this just group of dudes, you know, with a handful of women thrown in there. And it was like, hey, this, you're going to lead this team. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay. So here we go. And that's when we really started to formalize a lot of the apologetics ministry at Watermark. That's a whole other story that maybe we can get into in a minute.
But, about how many people work with you right now in that ministry?
We normally have between 22 and 24, we call them facilitators, who oversee our Monday night ministry where people can come in. It's like a living room environment, and they can come in and it's an open forum. You can ask whatever you want. Mm-hmm. So we never know what people are going to ask. They just come in and it's a it's fair game. So it's a lot of fun.
So when we think about the whole concept of apologetics, of defending the faith, we have the positive side where we give people reasons to believe.
Yeah, right.
We have the more defensive side where we help people answer challenges, work through challenges that they're maybe going through in their own minds, times of doubt. How would you explain to somebody, if someone were to ask you, why do you have an apologetics ministry and equipping ministry at your church? How would you explain the importance of that in terms of how that fits in the church mission?
Yeah. I mean, my first thought is, if you're doing evangelism, then you're going to be doing apologetics. Mm-hmm. I mean, you don't go up to somebody who doesn't believe and just be like, believe, and then they just believe. Like, that's, I mean, that's not how it works. So, I think one of the reasons that we've been able to have a strong apologetics ministry at Watermark is because our senior leadership has pushed forward a very strong community ethos of evangelism. Mm-hmm. So if you go to, I mean, probably if you're listening to this, or if you're watching this and you know somebody who goes to Watermark or you've heard of it, then you probably, at least in some, at some point in time, have heard them talk about Jesus or share their faith, or I mean, it's just evangelism is a high value for us. It's not aspirational, it's real. And so a lot of our great questions, which is the title of our apologetics ministry, a lot of our great questions ministry was born out of just necessity, because everybody's sharing their faith. And so, of course, you share your faith and somebody asks you a question and you don't know the answer to it, right? And so you're like,
yeah, we've all been there.
Help, please, you know? And so we just built a team that not only equips our body, we do equipping stuff for our body, but also just provides that area where we're like, hey, if you don't know the answer, then bring them to us, you know? And that's really the majority of our apologetics ministry is born out of our members who are active in personal evangelism.
How much of the ministry is split between, say, the more evangelism side for seekers, for people with questions, people in other religions, versus the discipleship side? That's the more equipping side.
Yeah, it's disproportionate in toward the skeptic. Okay. So we tell people, we're like, hey, this is for people who, two categories. One, questions are keeping you from a relationship with Christ, or two, questions are keeping you from growing in your relationship with Christ. So either people who are considering Christianity or are having like a crisis of faith. And so that's who we target. And so the equipping side of it tends to happen a little bit through some courses that we teach, but the ongoing, you know, week in, week out ministry is to people who don't yet believe.
Okay, that's awesome. So you mentioned great questions. So that's the you can ask any question you want.
That's right.
For people, atheists, people of other religions. What about the other offerings that you have? Tell us about those.
Yeah, so we really view Monday night is what we've already talked about, where people can come ask whatever they want. And we really view that as a front door because, I mean, we can have, in fact, this summer, we've had high numbers, I mean, between 30 and 50, like every single week come in. And that's, I mean, we try to keep it small because, I mean, think about it. You're maybe you went to church as a kid and then you've stopped going to church and you kind of did 20 years worth of whatever, right? And then you come back and like maybe great questions is the first time you've stepped in a church in 20 years, you know, which is not super common, but it definitely happens. You know, people come in and, you know, I've been away from the church for a long time, or people who have never been in church at all. Although we have a lot of international students, and here in Dallas, I mean, Dallas is very much a cultural melting pot from around the world. And so we've had all kinds of students come in, and this was not only their first encounter with a church, but their first encounter with Christianity, mm-hmm. you know? And so it's a, we try to keep it as small as possible, as the least amount of intimidation, you know? And so when you have a room full of people and you want to ask a question, then it's intimidating to raise your hand in yeah. a room full of 50 people. So we try to keep it really small. We found that that's worked, but we found that also is really that time is like the front porch or the front door to really get into a relational space with people. Mm-hmm. So we encourage and we follow up with people to say, hey, we'd love to buy you coffee or lunch or a meal or breakfast, whatever. We just want to hear your story. Because as you know, I mean, you do apologetics. I mean, you can answer somebody's questions, but I tell people all the time, I'm like, hey, you're not actually answering a question. Mm-hmm. You're answering a person.
That's right.
And the person is asking a question. The question is actually very quite secondary, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, the primary deal is, who are you? What's your story? Where did you right. come from? What shaped the way that you think about the world and God, mm-hmm. and not just what you think about him, but how you think about him. And does that line up with scripture? And you just can't know that in an initial meeting.
Yeah.
And so we really try to cultivate relationships with people so that we're meeting with them outside of that Monday evening expression. So that that's where the real work, I would say, of apologetics is going on. And so that's really those are kind of two sides of the same coin for mm-hmm. us, but that's the, that's apologetics for us there at Watermark.
Yeah. Well, listening is such an important part of that.
Where you're just
having
huge.
A meal with somebody, and it's really important to allow someone to share their, not only just their story in general, but their own views. Once they start opening up to start telling you their views on God, on
totally.
Jesus, on the Bible. We miss out on that sometimes if we're too quick to just try to give people answers to what we think they're asking. But they're really giving us a window into their souls and really where their heart is at when they share, you know. So that's amazing that you guys get to take that time with them outside of that Monday night.
Yeah, and I would say that probably one of the greatest failures, or maybe that's too strong of a word, one of the greatest mistakes that I think a lot of evangelicals make is we think of evangelism as like closing the deal, you know? So these kind of weird things start happening. Like you start to feel like a used car salesman because mm-hmm. you're trying to push people towards, yeah, but I mean, do you want to like pray this prayer or whatever kind of expression that takes? Mm-hmm. Do you want to accept Jesus? And unfortunately, Mikel, I think there's a lot of people who are trying to push toward that because of insecurities in their own lives. Their spiritual life a lot of times is deficient, and so they're trying to fill that void with like ministry activism so that they can raise their hand and go, see how the Lord used me, so that they can get this sense of self-worth for, you know, and that expresses itself a lot of times by people who don't listen. Mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. they're using the space when someone else is talking to formulate in their own minds how they're going to respond.
Right.
Instead of actually listening to what the person is saying. And what I would say to that is we don't get to do that. Like Jesus has called us to love people. And that looks like treating them with value and worth because they are valuable mm-hmm. and they do matter to God. And so you're not talking to, you know, when you do apologetics or evangelism, you're not talking to somebody who's another notch in your belt. Mm-hmm. You're talking to somebody who's made in the image of God, who's deeply loved by God, who deeply matters. Their story matters. Their views matter. And so, we don't get to just mow over people. We have to love them.
Yeah. And people can sense right away if you're treating them like a project, they can tell that just shuts down communication. And I mean, how did you think about 1 Peter 3:15, mm-hmm. our command to be prepared always to give an answer mm-hmm. to anyone who asks us about the hope that we have in Jesus, but do it with gentleness
yeah, right.
and respect.
Yeah, that part gets left off a lot.
That's right. And the whole context of 1 Peter 3, how did God you know, what was God's attitude toward us before we had embraced him or his message? Mm-hmm. And why can't we be like that with other people? It's how God was with us.
Yeah. Well, it requires somebody to take their personal walk with Jesus really seriously. Mm-hmm, I mean, you can't just, we have to get away from kind of the superficial Christianity, but I go to church, I do these things, I'm checking these boxes, but the actual substance of a vibrant, healthy relationship with Christ a lot of times is missing for people. And so, I mean, I would say if they're like, hey, how do you do evangelism? How do you do apologetics? How do you do these things? I mean, the first thing I would say is, hey, you got to get close to Jesus. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a way that you can do these things and do them apart from the energizing work of the Holy Spirit. It's called legalism, you know. But there's a lot of us that fall into that, you know, as opposed to, hey, that's not the ultimate aim. Like, I'm never asking myself, you know, how can I do evangelism today, you know? The question is, hey, how can I agree with Jesus? How can I walk with Jesus today? Because I promise you, if you get close to Jesus, you will do evangelism and apologetics. Because, you know, if you follow him, he's leading you to, I mean, he's saving the world. Mm-hmm. So if you're near him, that stuff will absolutely spill over and you'll be involved. But then you'll be involved not in your own strength. You're going to be, he's with you, right? And you're co-laboring with him in the gospel.
Mm-hmm. So when it comes to the people in the church who you're you're trying to train them to be able to give those answers, mm-hmm. what are some of the classes that you offer both in the Sunday school hour versus outside Sundays? How does that work with you guys?
Yeah, we've taken advantage of just technology and understanding that, I mean, the vast majority of people, we were talking about this before we went on, just a lot of people are consuming content online. Mm-hmm. So YouTube or podcasts or anything like that. That's just kind of the end thing right now. And so the question is not, well, you know, are they going to do this or not? They are doing that. Mm-hmm. The real question is, how do we meet them in that content consumption where they mm-hmm. are? And so we've developed one of our, we used to call them core classes, but now they're just equipping courses, is called Answering the Tough Ones. Mm-hmm. And we take six of the most commonly asked questions of the Christian faith and take about 90 minutes for each question and walk them through, like, hey, here's the issue. Here's how you need to think about this. Mm-hmm. Here are some points that we would encourage you to, you know, push forward in a conversation. But then there's also this piece in that course that is not just this is the information. It's also coaching people on how to have the conversation, how to engage the person. And because that's just as important mm-hmm. as the content. Mm-hmm. I mean, like, yeah, we could talk about that more if you want. I could get on a soapbox, but I'll spare you guys. That's just as important. And so we've taught that class, and then now it's available as on a cohort mm-hmm. base mm-hmm. online. So anybody can take it in the world as long as you have an internet, you know, as long as you have internet access. And so we try to utilize that. And then we also do a lot of different like seminar type things. Mm-hmm. You know, Dr. Bach's been with us on a handful of those, and whether they're seminar style or a conference, or we're pretty consistently throwing apologetics content at our body. Mm-hmm. But I would say that Answering the Tough Ones is the primary one that we push people toward. For no other reason, like, you know, if it just gets the conversation started with them, mm-hmm. it whets an appetite, then we have a ton of resources we can throw to people as they're like, whoa, I want more, you know? Mm-hmm. So,
So you're talking earlier about, maybe we will get into that, the way in which we engage is mm-hmm. so important.
Oh, I think that's huge.
When people have questions, one, if they just have questions in their own mind, the wrestling with their own doubts, mm-hmm. there's the answer so that you don't have to lie awake in bed at night wondering how can there be a God when there's evil in the world. Mm-hmm. But then also, so once you get the answer for yourself, how do you share that answer with somebody knowing that the question they're asking might come from, you know, 5, 6, 7 different areas in their lives?
Yeah, of course.
Where they're seeing dysfunction, where they're seeing the effects of sin. Mm. And, you know, you might be taking a pastoral route before you actually answer, you know, the evidential problem.
Totally. Yeah. A story comes to mind. We were Monday night, this was a couple years ago now, but there was a woman who came in, and she had come a handful of times before. Mm-hmm. Because it's an open forum, you can come as much as you want. And she had come a couple of times prior and had asked all of the major questions that a Muslim would ask of the Christian faith. So, you know, has the text been corrupted? Did Jesus really die on the cross? You know, those types of things. And so we answered all of her questions. You're consistent when you're in the room with those people. My radar is always up. Like, what's actually going on here? Mm-hmm. And look, there are unicorns out there where, like, whatever they're asking is actually what they're, you know, what's driving them. But they're few and far between. Most of the time, as you said, there's a bunch of stuff behind what the questions are. And so I was just kind of aware, and I was praying, because we pray a lot. And I was like, "Hey Lord, how do you want me to interact with her in this moment?" Because there's 20 other people in the room, you know. And so I called her by name because she had been there. I was like, "Hey, let me just ask you a question. I feel like you've asked a lot of different questions of us, and I feel like we've given you pretty satisfactory answers. Like, if we haven't, please let us know, because we want to clarify. But I just want to ask, like, what's behind this? What's driving this?" And the room got real still, because everybody's like, oh snap, junk just got real, man. And it also got really quiet because she started to cry. So I'm like half going, okay, now we're getting somewhere, and the other half of me is going, oh dang it, I just made somebody cry, you know. So it was just real still for a little bit, and she finally just said, I actually think you guys are right. Like, I want to believe this, but my husband is Muslim, and I'm afraid if I convert to Christianity, he's going to kill me, you know. And, you know, now all the smoke and mirrors of the questions are gone, and you're dealing with the actual problem, you know. And so there was a girl in there with us who has a degree from Dallas Seminary in counseling, which is great. And so I asked her to step out with her and spend the rest of the time, you know, just a focused one-on-one. And we labored with her, but that just illustrates, like, you don't ever want to be weird about it, you know, and be like, hey, what are you really asking? But you do want to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit, who could be in that moment drawing that out. And so you just have to, it's an art form, you know.
Yeah, definitely.
You have to listen and be sensitive to what's going on.
Yeah. One question I like to ask is just another way to put it is, you know, of all the questions that you could ask about God, why that one?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a fair question,
yep,
right?
It's good.
And then just, you mentioned prayer. Sometimes it's so basic, but sometimes it's overlooked when someone says, I want to get apologetic into my church. And they whip out Reasonable Faith by William Lane Craig.
Yeah,
and
right.
They just want to, you know, teach that class. But, you know, where is God asking you to step in?
Yeah.
Where is God, first of all, where has God placed you? Whether you're in a small church, whether you're in a large church, whether you're on staff or not, where is God asking you to step in and just ask him, you know, and just pray about it?
Totally.
How do you handle integration? You said you just throw apologetics content at the body wherever you can. Do you do integration in terms of, like, do you reach out to like for pulpit ministry? Do you get apologetics into there? Women's small groups, youth?
Yep,
how do you integrate that?
Yeah. So again, I would say, and this is a really critical point that I would encourage, you know, pastors who are listening or watching this. We have a saying around Watermark. It goes like this. I don't know if we came up with it or not. I'm just repeating what I heard. Is average leaders think in terms of programs, and above average leaders or great leaders think in terms of values. So a lot of times people are going to go, man, we need an apologetics ministry, whether it's because they think it's cool or in vogue or whatever it is, you know. And they'll be like, we need an apologetics program, so let's start a program. And I would say, don't ever do that. Like, why? Right? I mean, just because you start a program doesn't mean that that all of a sudden becomes a value for you, you know? Instead, I would say, heat up the value. Like, don't start a program, heat up the value. And the value is, are you sharing your faith? Like, that's the critical question. And if your church is not active in evangelism, don't start an apologetics program. Like, teach your church to share their faith. And you do that by a bunch of different means, but primarily by modeling it for them. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, that's a core principle in the army. Like, you don't lead from behind, you know, you lead from the front. Mm-hmm. You don't tell the people, you guys need to be sharing your faith, and then you don't ever share your faith. Like, so the way we champion this at Watermark is, I don't know if you've ever met our senior pastor, Todd Wagner, but that dude, I mean, he's just a... he's a thoroughbred when it comes to evangelism. Like, that's one of the unique ways that God's gifted him. And he's just always talking about sharing his faith and that's real. Like, mm-hmm. I mean, I go to lunch with him or I'm out with it and he's always sharing his faith. Mm. And so you kind of feel bad if you don't, because you're like with him and you're like, I didn't share my faith. I'm sorry. Right. But that's real. And so it spills over. And so a lot of our ministries, whether it's our apologetics ministry or our marriage enrichment ministry, which has a lot of people from outside the church come in because mm-hmm. their marriage is on fire, mm-hmm. you know, and they're mm-hmm. like, help, you know, our recovery ministry, regeneration is similar to that. And so the people will come in and they don't know the Lord. And so as you share your faith, then the apologetics just becomes like a necessary ministry mm-hmm. because there's a bunch of lost people around. And isn't that the way the church is supposed to be, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. And so I would just encourage people to think about it in terms of that. Like, don't start a program, heat up a value. Mm-hmm. And as you heat that value up, you can't stop. You will have to have an apologetics program mm-hmm, mm-hmm. because there's just people laying everywhere. It's like, well, we got to help these people.
Yeah. You know? You think about one of the earliest apologetics for Jesus as Lord and Messiah in Acts 2. Peter is doing it in the context of sharing the gospel.
Yeah, that's right.
Yep. And all these people get saved.
Yeah.
We don't ever, I always like to remind myself and people who are in apologetics ministry, our goal isn't to get people to assent to intellectual truths. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. We want people to have the power of God in their lives to encounter God
yep.
and to follow him and really have an authentic relationship. That's
yep.
that's the end of the thing. It's not just, you know, you get to ascend to the Christian worldview and now I'm happy.
Yeah.
That's not the point.
Yeah, there's plenty, as you know, I mean, there's plenty of people who believe that Jesus is who he said he was, but that doesn't mean that they're regenerated by the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I mean, and I would say too, this has been working on this in my doctoral program, but there's a bunch of people who can easily agree with a set of doctrinal propositions, mm-hmm. you know, but that doesn't mean that they've experientially or emotionally like connected to the truth of mm-hmm. the gospel. And so you want to do, in fact, I ask people in our interview process when I'm interviewing people to join the team, which is not an easy interview. I'm like, hey, on the spectrum, like, do you tend more toward like the rational side and just, you know, cogent arguments and, you know, convincing people from that stage or from that perspective? Or do you like tend to be more pastoral where, and really what we're looking for is somebody who is a good blend of both. Mm-hmm. They're able to pastor people and also be able to hang with them intellectually as they're asking very, very good questions that people need to be asking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So
when you take the value, then you heat that value up mm-hmm. in your church. That's, mm-hmm. well, step one, I suppose, is prayer, right? That's
yeah.
just basic, but
yeah.
sometimes we need to mention that. So pray.
No, you definitely
Lord
should. Yeah, because there's a lot of people who, like I said before, there's a lot of people who do all this stuff and they don't rely on
right.
the Holy Spirit. That's a problem.
it is. So then you heat up this value in your church and it starts to then spill out into not just a class that you're doing, but it'll be in the pulpit, it'll be in youth ministry,
yep.
it'll be in small groups.
Yep.
What would you say would be the next step for someone who, let's just say someone's on staff,
mm-hmm.
okay, and they have the ability to do this.
Yep.
We'll get to the lay leader later.
Yep.
So what would be the next step after that?
Well, you've definitely got to find your champion. I mean, once the value is heated up, then you're looking for the guy who is already doing it. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So you're don't ever put somebody in leadership who's not already doing what you're asking them to do.
Hmm.
That's not a good thing. So you're looking for that guy who's like, hey, whether y'all do this or not, I'm here, you know,
yeah.
and you're like, all right, you know, we can play with that. And so you're looking for that guy who's going to be he's a gifted, visionary, godly leader who's going to carry the flag, you know. And you can see them. I mean, once you heat values up like this, mm-hmm. I mean, you know the old adage, like the cream rises to the top, you know, and the people who are just kind of messing around and playing games, they'll fall away. the people who are like, no, I'm serious about this, they'll stick around. And so with them, you find your team. And I would say, especially with apologetics, you know, there's a bunch of different people that are interested in it. Mm-hmm. Because most of the time, in my experience, it's because they want to know how to answer questions, mm-hmm. but aren't really equipped to do so, which is totally fine. That's where they are. I mean, I've got equipping opportunities for them. But for the people that you want leading the apologetics ministry, they need to have thought about these things. They need to have been trained in some way. Mm-hmm. They need to have a good baseline understanding of, hey, this is what's going on with this. And then you begin to deploy them. I mean, our very much one of the bedrock verses of our equipping ministry at Watermark is Ephesians 4:12. You know, he's given us as pastors to equip the mm-hmm. saints to do the work that he's given them to do. You know, it's their ministry. And so even though I serve in our apologetics ministry, I'm not there every single Monday night. I help behind the scenes to equip our team, to help organize the team, all that kind of stuff. But at the end of the day, when the actual ministry happens, I'm just another voice on a team of, you know, 22, 23 people. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so we're deploying people and not doing it for them. You know, I mean, we say all the time, you're like, if you're doing the ministry for your people, then you're doing it wrong. Like, you're in the way, you know? And so get out of the way. Stop. Get out of the way. Right. Let them go. You know, God's called them to do that. So
that is our job, is to equip people for works of
absolutely.
Service.
Absolutely.
Not to try to do everything ourselves.
Yep. And when you do that, good luck trying to take that ministry away from mm-hmm. them. I mm-hmm. mean, it's a so then, like, we don't ever have to worry about volunteers. Do we have enough people? Those are not issues mm-hmm. for us, because when people own something, then I mean, they're bought in. Mm-hmm. You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think one of the crowning glories of a minister who's able to move from one ministry to another is when they move, the whole thing doesn't fall apart.
Totally.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, you did it right.
Yeah. Know? Yeah. Yeah.
It doesn't rise and fall on you.
No.
It's God's
no.
ministry yep. and not yours.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And these are God's people. He loves them more than you do. Mm-hmm. So, well, okay. Let's transition to now. There's a person who is in lay leadership in mm-hmm. the church, and they want to get their church on board with this kind of thing. They see the need. They're not really sure, who should I approach? Where should I start? Yep. God's kind of put this burden on my heart. I've prayed about it. What advice would you give them?
Yeah, I think we would start by saying, hey, good for you. You know, like, you can do your ministry whether or not the program exists in the church or not. And so the first thing I would say to them is keep going. You know, there may not be a structured program for you to plug into at your church, but that's okay. God didn't say, hey, here's your ministry, and oh, by the way, here are all the prerequisites that have to be in place in order for you to do your ministry. No. He just called you to do your ministry. And so that, number one, is be faithful to Jesus, you know, regardless of what that looks like, whether it's here or whether you're traveling for business or whether, like, I mean, your ministry is not confined to a specific location mm-hmm. or expression, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're an apologist at your church and at your workplace and in the airplane while you're traveling mm-hmm. and on the bus. And, like, it goes with you wherever you go.
Yeah.
And so that's the first thing. The second thing I would say is, if you do see a need, then I would approach a staff person in the church and just say, hey, I've seen this need. Here's how I've been a part of the solution. And I would love to see us maybe address this need in a certain way. I've got some ideas about it. You know, there's also this happens quite a bit at Watermark. Hmm. There's also this sense of don't ever raise an issue if you don't have a solution. You know, there's all kinds of people that gripe and complain about, right. Well, we need to do this, you know. And so a lot of times, especially people who are new, because if you're not new to Watermark, then you know not to gripe and complain about that stuff, because a lot of people will be like, man, why don't we have this, you know? And our answer is, why haven't you started it?
Yeah, go ahead.
You know? Yeah, like, what are you waiting on?
Yeah.
And it's funny how when the person who, why don't we have this? And then you tell them that, they're like, and they immediately backpedal.
Yeah.
You're like, hey.
Some people feel like they need permission to do something, but isn't it true that ministers love would rather, instead of somebody saying, why don't we have this kind of apologetic study group, would come up to you and say, hey, by the way, I hope it's okay, but I've been doing a study of Greg Kokel's tactics at my house for the past 3 months.
I love it. But see, that's what we look at. We find the people who are doing that and we're like, it's awesome. Like, you're on my radar. Mm-hmm. And how can I come around you and support you? And so I would just say to probably for the layperson who wants to get this started in a church or have some kind of expression of this in their church, sometimes you're going to run across a staff person who might be feel threatened by that. Like, hey, I'm doing this. Do you think we should do this? And they're like, whoa. You know, we didn't say that that was okay or whatever. And I would say that as long as the Lord's got you there, then it's kind of like a Daniel leading up to, you know, to his king, where he's like, you know what? Okay. I can play by whatever rules we have. That's fine. I'm flexible. You can still do your ministry. You don't need permission for that. And then I would say, like, slowly, you know, just in appropriate ways, continue to raise the, hey, you know, I feel like I've got a good solution for this. And then at some point, though, there is a time where it's like, I mean, if the church is just like, no, we're just not going to do that. We don't value that. We don't. Then I would say at that point, I think it's time to start looking for new leadership, you know, not necessarily at the church, like don't like usurp people and kick people out. But I think at some point there is a time where it's like, you know what? I don't think this is like optional for me. So I'm going to shift to a local expression of the church that. Is going to meet my values where they are. And I think that's totally fine. I don't start there.
Yeah.
You know, but I think after a process of working through it, I think that's totally appropriate. So, yeah.
It's always good. I tell people to Greg Kokel. We had him on the show recently, and he always likes to say,
he's a friend of mine. Yeah, he's good.
He likes to say, bloom where you're planted.
Yeah,
and I like
right.
that.
That's right.
Yep. So, not everyone has to be a debater. Not everyone has to be leading up this, you know, their own apologetics ministry.
Yep.
If God has you leading, little book study groups at a coffee shop, and that's your ministry, then God bless you.
Yeah, please. Like, that's what we need more of. I mean, that's the grassroots kind of stuff because it's relationally driven. You're across from the table from somebody who has real questions. And it's okay if you don't know the answer to their questions. Like, that's one of the things we say. I tell our team all the time, I'm like, if you don't know the answer to the question, just say, I don't know.
Yeah.
And that's a perfectly acceptable answer, response to their question. But just make sure you follow it up with, hey, I don't know, but why don't we explore that together?
Yeah.
You know, like now you've just created a relational engagement with somebody where instead of trying to, because a lot of people do, they feel like, this is one of the ways that Kokel, I think, has been really helpful for me in that book, Tactics, is... He's like, a lot of people feel the weight of all of Christendom on their shoulders to respond. It's like, oh, I've got to have I've got this awesome response.
Right.
And he's like, no, you just need to put a stone in their shoe. You know, this stone in the shoe principle where, you know, whether it's a response or the way you engage with them, where they walk away and it's like a little pebble. You get, you know, you ever have a pebble in your shoe and you're walking, you're like, man, this is annoying. You know, like, I got to get that out. And a lot of times that stone in the shoe principle is the getting it out is to come back around, to circle back around. People will come back and be like, man, that's really interesting what you said there. And so you don't give them the final answer. You might just give them a piece of the answer and they'll come back and want more for sure. But those grassroots, like across the table from people kind of ministries, that is apologetics. So don't think of it like debates with professional people. Like there's very few people who do that, right?
Yeah.
And I would say that, that while that is an expression of apologetics, it should not be the dominant one. The dominant one should be the conversation you have with your neighbor, the conversation you have with your coworker, the conversation you're having sitting across the table with somebody. And if you don't know the answer, there are say that, invite people into an engagement, and then there are plenty of resources to to pursue the answer to that, including us and including you guys, you know, like email us, call us. We'd love to help.
Yeah. Just getting somebody to the next step in the conversation, even just getting to the next conversation.
Oh,
there
it's huge.
Is even a next conversation.
That's right.
That's a step in the right direction right there.
Yep.
We don't have to pretend to have all the answers or feel like, well, now I have to defend the entire contents of the whole Christian worldview because someone just expressed a view I disagree with.
Man, who can even do that? I mean, Dr. Bach's not here, so I mean, he can't even do that, you know, like nobody has all the answers, but we do know the way, right?
Yeah.
And Jesus is like, hey, bring him to me. I got him.
You know? Jesus is the way.
That's right.
That's awesome. You know, when I was a youth pastor in San Francisco, there was a guy who was an atheist, married to a Christian. His wife became a Christian and they started going to the church, and they were going to the church for like 4 years. Mm. And after a while he told me, you know, Mikel, I pretty much have all my questions answered.
Yeah.
The only thing I have to ask myself now is, do I want to give control of my life over to someone else? Mm-hmm. And when you get someone to that point, where's the next step when we, you know, you're moving out of equipping and apologetics and you're moving into now a more pastoral role? Do you handle that within your ministry, or do you give them to counselors? Or
No. We have. I mean, look, if we can't handle that question, what are we doing?
Okay.
You know, I mean, that's, and so typically the way that we handle that issue is, again, you're recognizing that, hey, I'm not the solution to your problem, you know? And there's a lot of transference that can happen in those moments where people are looking to you to be the answer, or to give them a final answer, or to, hey, take all this angst that I'm feeling away from me. And actually, I think the Holy Spirit is using that angst to create tension points in that person's life to force them to choose. And so you're recognizing that that's going on. And then at the same time, I think a counter question to that question is, I'm not really ready to give up control of my life. I mean, I think I would just ask them the question like, well, yeah, it may be costly to give up control, but what does it cost you not to? You know, like, and most of the time people have a very pervasive sense of their own brokenness. And they realize that even though they functionally try to be God, they're not very good at it. And a lot of times just asking those probing questions to pull that up from underneath the surface to just go, hey, that's totally fine. You don't have to give up control to God. I mean, that's one of the miracles of creation, is that, you know, you do have a choice. However, that choice has consequences. And oh, by the way, like, saying this as gently as I can, like, how's that working out for you? You know, I told a guy just recently who is walking away from his faith, which is really sad, man. That's being in this position too. You see people who do that. And I just told him, you know, in a very, he's angry at a lot of things. And the last correspondence we had, I just said, hey, man, I love you. God loves you. He loves you more than you'll ever know. And when it gets to the point where you can't take this anymore, then we're waiting right here. We're here. You know, that's, you're going, the thing that makes me sad is you're going down a road that's not, I know it's not going to end well. And I think you probably know it too. And so you just love people. You love them unconditionally. You look at them and say, you know, hey man, you don't have to give up control. But that's not going to go well. And when it doesn't go well, I'm here for you. And that's when I think, because when the stuff hits the fan, right, and people do come back to you, they come back and you're able to show them like, hey, that, you know, God never left you. He's not mad at you. He's not trying to, like, another thing we say a lot is, and he's not trying to rip you off. He's trying to set you free. But you do have to get to the point where you've got to let him. You've got to give up control.
Yeah, God does that a lot, doesn't he?
Yeah,
he
just goes,
well, you want to go your own way. I'm here when you're.
He does it because he loves us, and also he does it because we force him to. You know, we don't cooperate with him, and a lot of times too, I'll ask this in apologetic type conversations where people are like, well, God, why did God do this and that? And I was like, well, there are some things, like we've said, are beyond our ability mm-hmm. to comprehend. But a lot of times, though, it's like, hey, I wonder how when we respond to him in rebellious type ways over and over and over again, like, how does that make him feel, mm-hmm, you know? Mm-hmm. And so putting, like, flesh and bone onto this kind of abstract God, you know, it really helps people, which is... Maybe that's what the incarnation is all about. I don't know.
So tell us a little bit more about how people can get in touch with your ministry and then the resources that you mentioned that anybody can take, these mm-hmm. online classes mm-hmm. and things like that.
Yeah, well, you can email us anytime at greatquestions@watermark.org. That's our kind of catch-all email address, but it gets monitored, and we do respond to people's questions like that. And then I would say, if you want to, an easy, you know, since I'm here on your podcast, mm-hmm. then I'll give myself a push, is our Equipping podcast has a ton of apologetics, type, episodes on there. So, I would encourage you guys to check that out. That's called the Equipping podcast. And then also the Answering the Tough Ones course. You can go on our website, watermark.org/equipping, and you'll see our equipping courses, and that's one of the equipping courses you can take. Again, they're online cohorts, so there's people, I think we've got like 19 or 20 different states represented, and then some people in Guam, and then some random dude in Australia, you know, it's like taking a course. I don't know. He must know somebody at Watermark, but, there's people who get put into these cohorts, and then you walk through the content with a cohort online. And, so I'd encourage people to check that out as well. But if there's any way that we can serve the church, you know, I mean, obviously we are a church, but if we can serve the church, equip them, resource them in any way, or just encourage them, be a sounding board for them, we'd love to do that.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being on the show.
Yeah,
really
absolutely.
Appreciate it.
It's a pleasure.
Good to have you in the studio again.
Yeah, man.
Well, we thank you so much for joining us here on the table once again. If you have a topic that you would like us to consider for a future episode, please feel free to email us here at the table, and our email address is thetable@dts.edu. Again, that's thetable@dts.edu. And we hope you will join us once again on the Table podcast next week as we continue to discuss issues of God and culture.
Thanks for listening to the Table podcast. For more podcasts like this one, visit dts.edu/thetable. Dallas Theological Seminary. Teach truth, love well.